Hello there, one and all, ladies, gentlemen, boys and girls, and you as well, Fez. Don't adjust your sets, no, it's not him out of the time team. Tis I, the bold Charles Maguire, your genial mind host on this cultural historical extravaganza where I focus on some of the lesser known historical sites here on the beautiful island of Bute. I'm going to start with my personal favourite. Something that I've been almost obsessed with since I was a wee boy, and that is the Ascog coal mine. Let's go!
Hey, let's go! Huh? Yo! Ascog mine, here we come!
Ta-da! The Ascog mine. Now, I know it doesn't look very much. It's quite unimpressive actually from this side, from the outside. It looks more like a wee cave, just like a small cave. But I can assure you, it is not. It is your actual coal mine, which goes in for about, I don't know, a couple hundred yards, say. Maybe that, 100 yards or so. And as you can see, somebody has been trying to, I think, maybe cover the entrance with all this dead gorse. I think that's what they've been trying to do. Good on them. I don't mind in the slightest bit. Now, there has been mining, coal mining, in the Ascog area of Bute for, well, since the 18th century, 1700s. This actual mine only dates from 1916, and we know that from a series of articles that appeared in the local paper, the Buteman, of which I have cuttings in the house. We'll get back to that later on. However, during the First World War, about halfway through the First World War, there was a dearth of coal. Because of the blockade, there was tremendous demand for coal in Britain, as you can imagine, during the wartime years, to feed the furnaces of the industrial Lanarkshire and Glasgow for the war effort, you know. So coal was at a premium. And all sorts of wee mines like this were opened up throughout the country. It's called a drift mine. It's not one of these conventional mines where the miners would get into a pit cage and they'd be lowered down and then get out and walk along a tunnel to the coal face. No, this is a drift mine. Essentially, they just walked to the surface, to the surface of the mine, to the coal front where they did their day's work. And they weren't even called miners. They were actually called borers because they bored their way into the cliff face. The seam is to the right hand side down here. You'll see it later on in some of my pictures. However, a wee bit more about this mine. Now, at the time this wee mine was opened in 1916, the entrance would have been considerably bigger. I mean, it would have been large enough for me to maybe not walk full upright, full height, but at least to be able to get in, maybe crouch down a bit, and into the main chamber there, and then into the actual mine itself. However, over the years it's subsided, as you can see. The rock here is pretty, it's not all that strong. There's bits of it still, yeah, flaking off even today. And that's all that's left. The entrance has been gradually silted up with debris and dead things and all that kind of stuff. When this mine was opened, the quality of coal was said to be quite good. The coal seam stretched right across the island, under the sea, and continued over in Ayrshire, North Ayrshire field, where my own forebears worked. They were goose from Ireland. They were iron miners, and they came over to Airdrie and worked in the coal mines and the iron mines there during the big industrial revolution, around about the 1830s, 1840s. And that's where our family's connection with this wee mine comes in. because after the mine had been abandoned after the war, it lay empty for quite a number of years, completely disused, and it was actually flooded at one point. However, at some point between the two wars, it was opened again as a commercial interest, a small business, small commercial interest. And there was only one miner, one borer, and he was my wife Karen's grandfather, my daughter Haley's great-great-great-great-grandfather, James Elliott from Airdrie. He was a miner and he came down here and he worked this wee mine. He was a sole labourer, if you like. What they did was they collected the coal, and they would take it round the big fancy houses of Ascog and Montford, which were all, they all had coal fired at that time, and would sell these brickbats of coal to the houses there. But it was not a very successful commercial venture at all. Economically, it just did not work. So eventually the mine was closed down and abandoned, and has remained abandoned for quite a number of years now. At least 70, 80 years since this mine was worked. The kind of coal that they got also seemed to, the quality of the coal wasn't so very good now. They think they used up all the good quality coal. I have here, cunningly concealed about my person, a big lump of coal from this wee mine here, from Ascog Mine. As you can see, it's quite a bit. And that actually belonged to my wee bruv Les. I've borrowed it from him. He doesn't know. Well, he knows now, doesn't he? But most of the other coal, you can find wee fragments of coal, wee bits of coal, are all around the kind of debris field here beneath the entrance to the mine. There's lots of bits of broken rock with wee, and lots of wee chips of coal all over the place. But it's no good quality coal. It's very poor quality coal. What quality coal? What they called sparky coal. Because when you tried to light it in a fire, it all flared up and sparked up and banged and all that and went all over the place, you know, and burnt your carpet. So it wasn't really that high grade coal for domestic use, but it was good for industry. I've been down this mine since I was 12, so that's like 50 years ago. First time I went down was with my friend Eric MacDonald and my pals the Varney Boys, including our Patrick, who nearly scared the living proverbials out of us by jumping out of us in the dark down there. Since then, I've visited the mine many, many, many occasions, but it wasn't until, 2011, that I really did the full boona. I went down as far as you can go, because previously I hadn't been well equipped to do it. However, in 2011, wearing this very helmet, which was a gift from my good pal Big Tam Kelly from the Renton. Cheers, Tam. You can see that I have decorated it accordingly. I went down the mine here with my good friend Martin Dugan, and we more or less went down as far as you can get, and Martin took a series of pictures while we were down there, just to kind of record for posterity what Ascog Coal Mine really was and is like, because it won't last forever. And to be honest with you, I've kept the exact location of it pretty vague. Now, there's a good reason for that, and it's this. It's a bloody death trap, especially for kids. Stay away from Ascog Mine. It is not worth the risk, believe me. It is an extremely dangerous state. It has been flooded, as I said previously. There have been various roof falls, rock falls within it. You have to clamber about on your stomach to get through certain bits. You could quite easily get stuck. And if you don't believe me, wait till you see some of Martin's pictures. But anyway, my advice to you is this. My suggestion to you is this. Give Ascog Mine a miss. Because who I ask, what idiot would ever consider risking all to venture forth into that black, dark, deep abyss? Ah, what the heck, I might as well have another look here. What's the worst that can happen? Yo, better get out my trusty phone. This is going to be my source of light. Get my money out. Wife's bank card, she doesn't know I've got it. Can I have keys? Not very much help down there. Right, here we go for a wee look. Oh. We'll be right back.
blamey. Do yourself a really big favour and get this flipping place a miss, man. Oh my god, I'm getting choked for this. It's gallus, but oh, it's so gallus.
Well, that was Ascog mine. See you again in another 20 years. Forget it, I'm out of here. Fucking look at it. What? Yo.
Hello there. Back to base camp. Now, I might have sent out a little mixed message there when I came up out of the mine and said, it's so gallus down there, which it is, which kind of contrasts with what I said earlier about it being a death trap down there, which it is. So please go with the latter. It is too dangerous. It really is. And I'm not going back down it. Oh, I'm glad you sorted that out. Anyway, I was telling you about cuttings from the Butemen. And I'm not going to bore you any further, because I know I've spoken enough, but I just wanted to read this wee cutting here. And it was given to me by my good friend, Peter Morrison, Peter Mole. And it says, it's dated the 21st of March, 1916. Okay, the book called Coal Seams, Development Prospects. A good deal of interest was created in Rossy last week through the appearance of the following advertisement in a Glasgow Evening newspaper. Inverted commas. Contractors wanted to drive levels and headings in dual coal seam, 30 inches high, double shifted number 1 and number 2 coal mines, Rossy. Address letter, Mid Lanark Coal Company, Blantyre. And mineral borers wanted, leader and two men for Rossy Coal Mines. Address letter, Mid Lanark Coal Mine, Blantyre again. And then it says, on Saturday, a representative of the company visited Rossy along with Councillor J.M. Laurie, whose interest in the project to work coal in Bute is well known, inspected the surface seams at Ascog. The Ambrose Beck seams, you remember I made mention to that during my spiel, yeah, my rant, okay? The Ambrose Beck seams have also been examined on behalf of the company. It is stated that the examiner expressed himself as well satisfied with the indications of the presence of coal at Ascog and also as to its quality. It will be recalled that experimental boring for coal was pursued in Bute a few years ago, following upon Councillor Laurie drawing public attention to the existence of coal traces. But the work was not systematically followed up by the syndicate responsible for the investigations. Diverse opinions as to the extent and quality of the coal seams at Ascog and Ambrose Beg have been frequently expressed, but if the Midlanark Company take up the project of working the coal on the island on the thorough lines that their advertisements indicate, a definite result may be anticipated. And get this last bit here. Probably the present high price of coal and the exceptional demand caused by the war is the reason for this development in regard to the Bute coal seams. Apparently, it has been decided to take the matter up, and no time is likely to be lost by the syndicate in getting operations underway. I'm not quite finished yet. I know. You're saying to yourselves, is there no beginning to this guy's talents? Anyway, coal mining, right, okay. But I found another wee cutting. It's from the Daily Record, Saturday, January 27th, good date, 1912, and it says, the Marchioness's Ring. It is worth recalling that not so many years ago, a quantity of gold-bearing quartz was discovered in the vicinity of the Skier Woods, and that a local jeweller presented the then Marchioness, now Dowager, with a ring made from it. Her ladyship was so well pleased with the gift that she gave him several substantial commissions to execute, with the result that he did an excellent stroke of business, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, there you go. So, and it said at the top, though, Bute's Coalfield, and there's a blurb about the Ascog mine, that. But it also says underneath that, Skier Gold Mine recalled. Wow. Thanks, Peter, for that. Now, final word on Ascog mine. As I said to you when I was out there, I brought up this link. It's just a metal link. It's rusted to bottom, actually. Falling bits falling off it, it's still really heavy. There was a coal wagon, or the remains of a coal wagon, down in the kind of central chamber some years ago that we kind of unearthed, and that was part of it. And I broke it off and I brought it in, kept it, just as a wee kind of memento of the Ascog mine. There you go, together with my trusty helmet and my big lump of coal. And that, my friends, is the end of the episode for me at Ascog mine. And thank you so much for listening. Yo!